Shelf Life. How I Found the Meaning of Life Stacking Supermarket Shelves by Simon Parke. Read by Clive Mantle. Chapter 1. A Slight Change of Direction, in which a priest becomes an ex-priest and Winston makes plans to leave again. Michael, the lorry driver, mucks in. Bryn eyes up Faith. It's tales of the unexpected in a bedroom at 2 a.m. and caffeine makes all things well. People say that I have changed direction, though I'm not sure this is true. Certainly, I was a priest in the Church of England for 20 years before becoming a supermarket worker. But really, what's the difference? Roles may change, but unless we do, things are pretty much the same. We take ourselves wherever we go and attract or repel life accordingly. Take Winston, who is standing to my left on the till as we face the lunchtime rush. He tells me he once had an ambition to be rich and married by 33. He is now 40, single and poor, so on the face of it, things have not worked out as planned. He is not a happy man and imagines a change of job will help.
"I need a change of direction, Simon," he says. "A big change of direction."
"What will you do?"
"I don't know, but whatever it is, it will be a whole lot better than this. This is not what I want to be doing."
But he isn't unhappy because of the job. He's not even unhappy because he's poor or single, for he had a propensity for unhappiness way before that. He's unhappy because he's Winston, or a version of Winston at least. No external change of direction would make any difference to the congealed rage he keeps sealed inside. No, I didn't expect to be a shelf filler at the age of 50, or standing on the till, watched by suspicious customer eyes. I suppose I'd imagined I'd be a priest for life, burying, marrying, baptizing, and organizing the increasingly big annual parish pantomime. Fantastic. I'd even preached at St. Paul's Cathedral a couple of times, and for a short while had aspirations to be a bishop. Imagine it, a pointy hat and robes dripping with gold. How grand it all might have been. Instead, I am rearranging organic carrots, scraping the scum off the banana stand, and date-rotating the fruit salads, because after 20 years, I knew the adventure was over. It was time to leave the institutional church. Perhaps from the outside, it looked like a choice. To many, it was perhaps a shocking choice and a dereliction of duty. There was anger at my decision, anger from those who need you to be something for them. The roles we play can give other people's lives a semblance of order, and when roles change or are abandoned, it can be unsettling for the fragile, those who struggle to manage their inner chaos. With no inner pillars of their own, they need others to be strong pillars for them. Such folk are not helped by resigning priests.
"Once a priest, always a priest, surely."
"Has he lost his faith?"
"Makes you wonder, doesn't it? Such a waste. And rather sad, don't you think? I remember the time when a vocation was a vocation.
Unhappy with his job?
In my day, you just got on with it."
From the inside, however, it was no choice at all. When your home is on fire, you leave. I wouldn't call that a choice. It is something you simply do. And so I simply did. I left the church, my security, my home, and my keeper, and took up stacking shelves in a supermarket because, like Winston, I couldn't find anything else either. It was all simply mad, but happy also. The simple mind knows no obstacles. There are others here who might wish for themselves another direction. Take our lorry driver, Michael. Lorry drivers are honorary members of the shop community, staggering in early after their night drives, looking for a toilet, a hot drink, and a chat. Each driver must take ridicule for the football team they support, for football is the language spoken here. Sprechen Sie Fußball? They all do, except Michael. Michael doesn't support a team, and refreshingly doesn't pretend to either. His voice is educated and professional. He worked in IT for 25 years before he was made redundant when the government pulled out of their contracts. He still rages eloquently against the government. Fine words butter no parsnips, however, and so at the age of 51 he spent £2,500 of his own money to train for an HGV licence. He is now the unlikeliest of lorry drivers, without a trace of brown sauce on his shirt. Michael is mucking in because of the way things have fallen. As he says, if God gives you lemons, you make lemonade. This is so. You may not thank God for the lemons. Indeed, you may say, fuck the lemons, frankly. But the bills still need paying. So in middle age, Michael left his desk and learned lorry driving. Whether he has learned anything about himself, I don't know. And Winston, as we know, is also on the move, always about to hand in his notice. Do not expect to see me here for much longer, Simon, says Winston. I'm not holding my breath, though. There are 5 seasons every year, summer, autumn, winter, spring, and Winston leaving. In fact, I am surrounded by leavers, leaving, leaving everywhere, yet everyone still here. In dull fatherly fashion, I always say the same thing. The manager may be a complete shit, but consider your rent. Make sure you have something else in the bag before making the jump, because it's not easy when you don't. I speak with feeling when I say this. I had nothing lined up when I left the priesthood, not realizing how unemployable a former clergyman is. My writing earned me a little, but was generally rejected by agents, publishers, and newspapers alike. I took a cleaning job and coached 1 or 2 Somali children who were falling behind, and I found myself absurdly happy on discovering a fiver on the pavement, a telling moment in my fall from grace. I had traipsed around shop after shop, leaving my CV, but found no interest. They didn't even get back to me to say no. They said they'd be in contact, but never were. I tried 1 or 2 fast food outlets as well, but on finding the manager of one to be about 12 and the staff considerably younger, I knew I was in the wrong place. When someone did actually send a rejection letter, tears came to my eyes in gratitude. Gratitude that they had gone to such trouble. Thank you for turning me down like this, and headed notepaper as well. You're so kind. It is of passing interest to note that the only store to offer me a job was the store that did psychometric testing over the phone, and therefore knew nothing about my age or my past. I found it hard when people didn't get back to me, when I was left in limbo. I prefer to know news, good or bad. If I do not know it, my imagination is given too much room for exercise in the fields of unreality, and there is no health there. Imagination is a state between wakefulness and sleep, with the benefits of neither. Once I know the bad news and have taken the hit, my inner self can practice the art of recovery. Hope springs eternal is not something to be said to others in their disappointment. It will sound glib and irritate. But it is a profound personal truth when our reality is faced and accepted. It may not be what we wish for ourselves, but it is what is true for ourselves. We are eternally hopeful and happy people. And here is the beginning of healing. Our inner resources are remarkable, if we feed them the truth. Why did no one want me? Perhaps they imagined that as an ex-priest I would preach sermons at them. It is, I admit, an unattractive prospect. Obligatory joke becoming slick anecdote, becoming profound thought, becoming...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.